الحمد لله، نحمده ونشكره ونستعينه ونستهديه، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي، يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. نشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، ونشهد أن محمدا عبد الله ورسوله. We praise Allah and we ask Him to give us the guidance and the sincerity and the success that we need. And we ask Him to shower His blessings and peace on Muhammad, the mercy to the worlds, and the last of the prophets, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. We bear witness that there is no deity save Allah, and we bear witness that Muhammad is the servant and the messenger of Allah. Dear brothers and sisters, two statements in the Quran occupied my mind and my heart in these last few days. And I see them as very relevant and so pertinent to what we are going through these days in America. The first statement says, Al-fitnatu akbaru min al-qatl. Fitna is the state of chaos, confusion, and discord that disrupts the life of a society and cannot be handled. As a matter of fact, in one situation said akbar, greater, more, and in another verse said al-fitnatu ashaddu min al-qatl, more intense and tough than murder. I always thought that murdering a human being is the greatest sin ever in Islam after associating partners to God in worship. Nonetheless, here the Quran says that something more, which is al-fitna. And the reason for that is murder is a crime. It can be contained. The society can bring the perpetrator to justice and can take measures to prevent it and try to have it not happening again. But fitna is different. It is the disruption of the society itself and its inability to control its destiny. In that situation, so many people are murdered, so many property is lost. There is a state of discord that nobody can guide nobody. And this is the worst ever that can happen to society. The second verse is وَاتَّقُوا فِتْنَةً لَا تُصِيبَنَّ الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا مِنْكُمْ خَاصَّةً. And this verse is saying, be aware, caution against, prevent and avoid that situation that will not inflict the perpetrators alone. In other words, the wrongdoers who caused that will not be the only ones who suffer the consequences. As a matter of fact, in most of the cases, the brunt falls on the innocent and the unaware elements of the society who have nothing to do whatsoever with any agenda or with any plan or with any situation or even with any grievances. the Quran is saying that situation, don't think that it will be limited to the wrongdoers. It can inflict and hurt every person in the society. What made me feel that these two statements are so pertinent to us now is the last news about the foiled, alhamdulillah, thanks God, crime that was planned to be perpetrated and committed in New York. And this is really within a short time, the second one. There was the what they call the underwear bomber, and now we have this. And we notice two things here. Number one, that we were so blessed that these two attempts failed. They failed on their own. With all honesty, it is not because any one of us is smart. Just failed. Maybe Allah wanted to protect the country from such a chaotic situation like that. But it also tells us that the danger is very real and is here, and so far it is not securely contained. And that is really the issue that we need to talk about and to spend the time on. And let me tell you a few reflections that I think are very important for the people of America. And I want to state here, this is not a problem for the Muslims or of the Muslims. This is a problem for Americans. If it happens, it will hurt everybody. And to prevent it, we need the help of everybody. So trying to project it as a problem of the Muslims and there will be a backlash against Muslims or whatever is not accurate. It has some truth, but this is not the main problem, or at least this is not the angle where I am coming from. I am coming from the angle that this is a problem for all American people. Government and the citizens and everybody and all religions and all races. Because once we reach that threshold of fitna, of anarchy and discord, we all are very compromised and very endangered, as a matter of fact. So, based on that, I'm calling for a different approach. Usually, after each one of these incidents, and you just recall your memory, there is immediately starts a game of finger pointing. Immediately. The first fingers are pointed towards the law enforcement. And I know that we have very respected members of the law enforcement in our audience today. And the finger pointing is usually saying not what they did, but what they didn't do or what they should have done. And it is usually concentrating on the gaps or the mishaps or the overlooks, etc., etc. And I imagine, and I underline imagine because I am not in the law enforcement, but still, we are sharing the task together and we are all Americans. I imagine that their feeling can be how ungrateful people are. We are not sleeping in our homes, we are not spending time with our families, we are putting our life on harm's way, and all what we get is criticism. There is another voice that all praise, all congratulations, everything is nice and dandy. The problem between the two extremes is that none of them is completely true, and it ends up that the citizens are completely puzzled and confused, and this is the first step towards the fitna I'm talking about. When nobody sees clearly and everybody is either accusing or being accused, or accusing and being accused at the same time. The second finger pointing is towards the Muslim community. And again, and I have to admit gratefully and proudly that the official voices after that last incident did actually avoid the vulgarity of Islamic terrorism terminology. So we found that the government and the law enforcement talked about a person from Pakistan, about his background, etc., but it was not labeled by the officials as Islamic terrorism, a language that we are used to during the past 7 years or 8 years, as we know. Nonetheless, the non-official voices, the self-proclaimed experts, the people with special interests and special agenda, raised these voices, pointed fingers to the Muslims, and usually it is a whole range of things, from the ridiculous statement of why don't you condemn the terrorism, which I give it the correct description as ridiculous, to all the way, you should do this, you should do this, you should do that, why don't you go to the media, why don't you publish articles, and why don't you march in the streets demonstrating condemning terrorism? And the result of that, if it is left alone, is that Muslims become, or some Muslims become, in a defensive posture. We didn't do it. Most of us are good. Islam is great. We are good. We love you, you should love us, etc. And this is not very productive in reality. We have to always, as Muslims, especially when we stand on the member of Jummah, to stick 100% to honesty and the truth and the frankness. That results in wasting a very valuable asset, which the American Muslims and what they can do as partners with the government and with other citizens to protect the country. We are busy defending ourselves. We are not even given the chance to think in a creative way or in a progressive way to find the means to conquer this scourge of terrorism that can lead to the fitna that we are talking about. And after all, we are doing what we should do, not because we want the certificate of acceptance from one group or the other. No, it is because we sincerely believe that this is our religious duty to protect our country, our citizens, and ourselves, and our constitution, and our civil liberties. These are religious duties, to cooperate with good people for goodness, ta'awanu ala albirri wa taqwa, and not cooperate with bad people for bad things. These are Quranic instructions for us. We are not doing it to appease anybody or to upset anybody. We are simply doing it because this is what we are. This is why we had a grassroots campaign to fight terrorism about 5 years ago. This is why we had very important papers that were published and given to the officials and to the representatives in the Congress about counter-productive counter-terrorism and about how we win the ideological war. This is why we wrote and we published to defy and expose the fallacy of the ideology of destruction and the animosity. We are doing all of that without anybody telling us, why don't you go to the media? we are knocking on the door of the media every day. So it is up to the media to open the door or keep it closed. It is a free country. But we shouldn't feel guilty because I'm not talking on the media. I'm doing my job. And it is, as I said, it is not only my problem. It is a problem of myself and the media and the church and the synagogue and the Republicans, Democrats alike. They wanted to march in the streets in demonstrations. Let them go and do it. Why aren't they marching? Why they are coming to tell me what I should do? We are a mature community, and amongst the different American groups, we are one group that should be very proud of what we produced and what we offered already to protect the country against terrorism. We shouldn't feel compromised or embarrassed or apologetic whatsoever. The third quarters that come is what I call the clash of civilization crashers. Those are people who do believe, and now they don't criticize Muslims, they attack Islam itself. In other words, what they wanted to say is Muslims are good, maybe good, but Islam is not that good. As one person said on the TV recently, the only piece in Islam, in Quran, is to cut you into pieces. Smart. The guy is joking about a very serious matter. And that shows the level of irresponsibility that's prevailing in our midst. So all of these factors led to bring us where we are now. Simply, we are not productive in securing the protection of the country. And when I say we, it is the big we that includes all of us. So far, anything can happen at any time against our will, that with this background and the attitudes that I described can throw the country immediately into fitna and in chaos, which we should never allow to happen. So we will try to point towards some kinds of efforts and activities that we need to do. أدعو ربكم إنه هو الغفور الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله خاتم الأنبياء والمرسلين. My dear brothers and sisters, that danger, while our country is so vulnerable to be inflicted by a fitna situation, cannot be handled and will not be handled by one group alone. And we have to admit that. When they wanted to exclude Muslims because Muslims are either bad or pretending to be good. That was the equation of the right-wing equation. We did get nowhere. And as a matter of fact, we tightened the screws on the millions of innocent, while the professional murderers can get away with it. They have the know-how and the skill to get through the system. When we leave it to the law enforcement alone, we know and they know that it will not be done. If we leave it to politicians alone, politicians want to be re-elected, period. To the point that went so low that an elected representative advocates and calls for stripping the citizenship of any citizen who is suspected to do terrorist activities. This is worse than McCarthyism. But such a voice would have never been heard before. because it's killing the Constitution of the United States. It is an action against the United States, but it is voiced, and of course, inshallah, it will be defeated. People of religion, whether they are Christians and Muslims and Jews, should really stop the religious tribalism, that this group is accepted, this group is chosen, this group is selected, this group is the best, and I'm saying that including Muslims also. That tribalism and superiority attitudes in a pluralistic society will not get us nowhere. So I'd like it to go down on record, because we really, just in this hall, we have Muslims and non-Muslims, and we have government and we have law enforcement, and we have academicians and we have people of media, all in that hall. So I value this gathering. I think it is significant and it is important. So I want it to go on record that we are calling on a national project to protect the country, a national project with a national comprehensive strategy, something that did not happen so far. We are calling, we the Muslims from this mosque in Los Angeles, calling for a national convention and meeting of minds, where people of art, people of government, people of law enforcement, people of religion, people of media should come together in the spirit that we are going to lose it if we don't synergize and energize and comprehensively divide labor with one purpose: to keep the country safe. Safe from terrorism that will attack buildings or individuals, and safe from dangerous ideas that will destroy our constitution and our Bill of Rights. So we do all of that while we are insisting on protecting the civil liberties of every American, Muslim or non-Muslim, and of protecting the human rights of every human being in the world. We don't know how to start that. This is why I am calling, and I say it should be on record. Hopefully it reaches someone who has the capacity or the ability to initiate that. If this calling goes in vain, by God's support and help, we are going to start it. Let some people smile and say who they think they are. We are a group of Americans opening our arms and our hearts to all fellow Americans and inviting them for a serious debate, and to be very honest, excluded from that debate all voices of hate, of superiority, Islamophobes, or anti-Semitics. Those do not belong to that endeavor. That endeavor should be the mainstream America. If the government takes over that, then the President of the United States should call for it. We should convene under his leadership. He should even assign a czar, like we had for the war against drugs or whatever, and we will be more than happy to work for it. If somebody less than that or other than that is serious about initiating it, we Muslims should work with him or with her. If nobody does, we will do it. And this is the way we should see ourselves. We are the carriers of the Quran that tells us that our job is to serve humanity through enjoining what is right and forbidding what's wrong. And we are the followers of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who has been sent as a mercy to human being. And we are the group of Americans that did most to protect the country, so we can do it. We should never look at ourselves as a fraction or as a small. With the dignity in us, وَلِلَّهِ الْعِزَّةِ وَلِرَسُولِهِ وَالْمُؤْمِنِينَ, and with the support of Allah, وَاللَّهُ غَالِبٌ عَلَىٰ أَمْرِهِ وَلَكِنَّ أَكْثَرَ النَّاسِ لَا يَعْلَمُونَ, Allah will dictate His order. Even most of the people don't know. So we proceed and we do it. We might be wobbly, we might be weak, we might not have the enough funds, but we start, and Allah helps those who start. Allah don't help the ones who are sitting on the side whining and weeping and crying. Help those who do the right thing. And as I said, وَلَا يَنْصُرَنَّ اللَّهُ مَنْ يَنْصُرُهُ إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَقَوِيٌّ عَزِيزٌ, Allah will support whoever supports His cause. Allah is mighty and strong. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us the clarity of the vision, the sharpness of the mind, the courage of the heart, and the stamina to carry on His cause, the cause of justice, peace, and mercy. We ask Him subhanahu wa ta'ala to keep us right on the straight path, and to bless our efforts, and to join us with righteous people from all over and from all walks to work together to make this country the way it ought to be. We ask Him subhanahu wa ta'ala to forgive our mistakes, our trespasses, and our shortcomings, and to guide us always to the truth. Allahumma ighfir lana warhamna wa'afina wa'afu anna وتولنا وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم وصلى اللهم على محمد أقم الصلاة.